Researchers have always known that the rich have lived longer than the poor, but a recent study shows that despite advances in medicine, technology, and education, the longevity gap between these two groups in America has been widening dramatically. Economists at the Brookings Institution found that a wealthy American man born in 1920 lived about 6 years longer than a poor man born that same year. But for a man born in 1950, that difference has more than doubled to 14 years. For women, the gap went from 4.7 to 13 years. Here with us now is Dr. Lisa Berkman, the director of Harvard's Center for Population and Development Studies, to talk to us about this growing gap between income and life expectancy, the causes of it, and how we might be able to combat it. Thanks for joining us. So why is this gap growing?
Well, that's perhaps the most interesting question. But one of the things to put into perspective is that this gap has been growing for probably the last 50 years. So the difference between rich and poor was getting smaller and smaller through a great part of the 1900s through about 1950 or 60. And then something started to change. And that flip suggests that there's something about our environment, mm-hmm. something about our set of policies that would drive that. The really clever thing about the Brookings study, which is really outstanding, is that they divided each birth cohort. So if you were born in 1940, they divided you into 10 percentage point mm-hmm. deciles. So you could look at the people at the bottom, and you could look at the people at the top. People at the bottom, especially women at the bottom, had no increase in life expectancy over the last 20 or 30 years. None, zero. It was just complete stagnation. Whereas people at the top experienced these enormous gains, somewhere between 6 and 8 years. So what happened was people at the bottom stayed the same, mm-hmm. and all the benefits that have happened in terms of life expectancy over the last years have accrued to the best off in our country.
Are there behavioral differences? I mean, do the rich practice life differently than the poor do?
So we know that things like smoking and alcohol and physical activity are very, very important for health, but it turns out that while smoking may explain part of the mm-hmm. Difference in this inequality, it's unlikely that these behaviors actually explain very much. And in fact, in the Brookings report, they examined that quite carefully and came to the conclusion that behaviors were not the answer to this.
The type of work the rich do versus the type of work the poor do. Let's say if the poor are in coal mines more mm-hmm. often or around chemical noxious substances in their jobs, whereas the person in the corner office isn't. Does
right.
that start to factor
yes.
into this?
So I think so. Probably a set of job exposures are very important. It's interesting that the ones you pick, the physically demanding jobs, working in a coal mine, the kinds of accidents that people used to have at the turn of the century, that has been a huge success story in terms of federal regulation for occupational health and safety. So it means in some way that another set of exposures that are related to work might be on the lurch out there, and they might have to do with things like job security, work-family conflict, job strain, just the sheer hours of working. And when you think about that at the upper level, obviously, people who are in the upper reaches of education and income have many of those same experiences, but they have many, many, many resources.
Is there a geographic breakdown? Are there parts of the country that are more affected than others, or is it zip code by zip code in the same city?
Yes, yeah, so there's been a lot of work looking at geographic variation, and there are large regional differences in general. If we look at the South versus the North, for instance, life expectancy in general in many southern states is much worse. But the thing that you're alluding to is this difference in zip code, is that you could be in one city, and if you were in one zip code, your life could be very, very, very different from living in a zip code that was much better off.
I remember being in Baltimore doing some stories last year, and literally a matter of six blocks was
yes.
a massive difference.
Yes, like 5 years of life expectancy. You could get on the subway and end up in a zip code where life expectancy is 5 years different or 6 years different. Now, again, the reasons for that are pretty interesting to think about, because it's easy to think that they're all attributed to the neighborhood, mm-hmm. to that community. And it may be that there are some neighborhood variables and conditions that are very risky. We know, for instance, that physical pollution, environmental exposures, toxic exposures, get more concentrated in poor areas. So people who live in poor neighborhoods can be more exposed to physical environments with noxious kinds of risks. We also know that their social risks could be different, that levels of violence can be very different in different neighborhoods, job opportunities, access to healthy food, places to exercise. All of these things are patterned by neighborhood. So where we live is a very important determinant of this growing inequality, but it's not the only one. So I think we have to think about where we live, where we work, mm-hmm. and probably how our families are constituted.
Does access to healthcare play into this at all?
So it seems that healthcare is important, and the Affordable Care Act, I think, is terribly important in terms of providing access in terms of health improvement. But health insurance has another goal, which is to keep people out of poverty. So the idea is that if you had a heart attack, you could easily be swamped by the costs associated with hospitalization, and you might have to sell your house, you would lose your job, any number of bad things would happen. So health insurance can be good for you by preventing sort of economic shocks.
What about the other existing safety net programs we have, Social Security or Medicare?
Yeah, there are a number of examples of public policies that do work. One of the ones I often talk about is the Earned Income Tax Credit. So the Earned Income Tax Credit encourages low-income men and women to stay in the labor force, and it does that successfully. It also turns out that it promotes healthy births and infancy, and women who are on who get an Earned Income Tax Credit actually smoke less. Medicare, Medicaid certainly are policies that will soon be linked to the Affordable Care Act.
So are there other policies that you see that we could try to think about or push forward that would actually work on this gap?
Yes. So one of the most important areas we suspect is important is this work-family flexibility set of issues. So we are virtually the only country in the world that doesn't have a federal family leave provision, except an unpaid family medical leave. I think that might go very, very far. And in fact, we have data from Europe that in countries where people were exposed to family leave policies, when they were older, they were healthier, they were less depressed, and they stayed in the workforce longer. So I think we should think about a set of policies around work and family issues, flexibility, and of course, ultimately, we need to think about Social Security quite carefully.
All right, Lisa Berkman, thanks so much for joining us.
You're welcome.